Once I saw some interest in TikTok and Instagram and YouTube, that door was slightly ajar and then I kicked it open.
Dr. Karan Rajan.
Social media sensation.
Over 8 million subscribers across YouTube, TikTok and Instagram.
Known as the internet's favorite surgeon.
Sunday Times number one best-selling author.
And he's on a mission to debunk
the internet's biggest health myths.
Is this the biggest scam in healthcare today? Does it actually have any health benefits, or is it all just hype?
Unfortunately, I see creator after creator after creator that many people watching this podcast will recognize the names of. These people promote the same scams that I turned down, the same supplement companies. You see the best creators or the creators with the highest number of followings promote the hell out of it.
This episode is brought to you by Athletic Greens.
Athletic Greens is an all-in-one vitamin mineral probiotic drink.
We're going to be talking about Athletic Greens AG1.
So how much money do you make?
I would say I'm one of the creators with this size who probably isn't monetized as much as they could be. And that is by choice.
And that all started by you producing content online. And that is very much out of the ordinary.
All of my content is born out of my curiosity and my interest. I'm not claiming to be an expert in any one thing. And I'll be very wary of people calling themselves outright experts without credentials. It's just me on a journey to learn more things, exploring my curiosity and sharing my findings with my audience.
So walk me through your process, maintaining that professional integrity, but then producing accurate, engaging content.
I just know from looking at a piece of content, like, do you know what? This needs to go here and that's going to go viral. When I make a certain video, I know if it's going to do well.
I don't want to sound grandiose when I say this, but like, you think it's something inherently special about you? So where does this discipline and drive come from being a full-time surgeon to then also juggling a completely whole full-time job creating content online?
The truth is, you don't need to be a productivity expert or, you know, all of this kind of bullshit to balance everything. If you want a real productivity expert, go speak to a nurse who's a mother of 3 or 4 kids, who's working a full-time job doing night shifts and still managing a proper life.
Are you familiar with the Minecraft YouTuber Quibblecop? Using AI, he's cloned his face and his voice, and he now produces purely AI-generated content based on an AI script that reacts to real gameplay footage. So he's not actually in any of these videos.
The risk-reward ratio in that is not worth it, because the risk is that all it takes is one slip-up with AI to make something completely wrong that I've missed, and it goes out there, and it's bullshit, and it affects my credibility, which is priceless to me.
What would you have told yourself at the start of your 20s if you could go back, and by extension to that, what advice would you tell me?
Things happen for a reason. Even if you can't see the silver lining or the benefit of it now, at some point you will, even the bad moments. There are loads of points where maybe I have regrets, but I don't hold on to regrets for too long.
Hey guys, quick message for those of you who are new to the channel. My name's Esh and I'm a final year medical student. I actually just completed my last ever medical school exam today. So hopefully in a couple months time, fingers crossed, I will be graduating as a doctor. I just wanted to ask you all a favor, and that is please hit the subscribe button. Join me on my journey. On my channel, I explore the future of science, health and tech. And so please subscribe if that sounds interesting. It honestly means the world to me. Let's get into the episode. Karan, thank you so much for joining me on the podcast. I had to pull out all the stops to get you on. So it really means a lot that you're joining me today, because I know you're a really busy man. So welcome to the Health Beyond Tomorrow podcast.
Man, thanks for having me.
And another reason why this episode really means a lot to me is because I think you alongside Ali Abdul are two people that I greatly look up to, and you do inspire me. So to begin with, I want to hear your story. I know you moved from Mumbai to the UK. So tell me a little bit about what that was like, that transition and your experiences.
To be honest, I don't remember much of it. You know, I was born in Mumbai. I moved from Mumbai to Nairobi in Kenya, then to Hong Kong when I was, up to the age of 5. And then when I was 5, I came to the UK. And I was in international schools in Hong Kong. I could speak English already. My, you know, parents, they came to the UK partly because my mum, well, she's a doctor, and it was better career prospects for her being a doctor in the UK as opposed to anywhere else in the world. This is in the 90s. And for me, they wanted to give me the best education possible. And the UK has always been seen as a place where education is prioritized, and it's a place where you can give children a good education. Certainly you've got fantastic universities and schools, so they wanted that for me, and they wanted to give me the best of everything they could in life. And that was it, really. And here we are now.
So you mentioned your mum was a doctor there, so I'm probably going to ask a question that you probably always get answered, but was your fate determined to be a doctor before you even came out the womb? Like, oh, my son's going to be a doctor.
Yeah, probably. I mean, to be honest, out of both of my parents, my mum probably, when it push came to shove towards the time, she maybe, I wouldn't say discouraged me, but didn't ever big it up so much. You know, oh, you have to be a doctor. It was more my dad was interested in me being a doctor. He's a non-doctor, and maybe he wanted, you know, his son to be a doctor. But at no point did my parents pressure me to do anything. But I did feel there was maybe, I wouldn't say a hidden pressure, but almost an expectation that because I was good in science, I was good in maths, and my mum was a doctor, that I would follow in the footsteps. And I enjoyed all those things as well. So it sort of did seem like a path that was already carved out for me. In another world, what would I do if I wasn't a doctor? I also did German when I was doing my A-levels, and I still speak German pretty fluently now. I go to Germany quite a lot. I've got friends in Germany. So I don't know, I would have done something to do with languages, because I always, you know, had a fascination with learning different languages. You know, I learned French in school, German. I was learning Spanish over lockdown. In school, when I was younger, I learned ancient Greek and Latin. So I always liked languages and linguistics and etymology. So that would have been probably another career for me if I hadn't been a doctor.
Do you ever think of that where, like, I don't know if you've seen the new Spider-Man with like all the different Spider, like yeah. You're a bit of a nerd, right? I know, I follow you on Instagram and you talk about the multiverse quite a bit. Do you ever think of that? Like, what would another Karan be doing in another universe right now?
Yeah, it's fascinating to think about, you know, what would another version of me or different versions of me, plural, in different universes. I don't know, like probably all the actions that I didn't take, the path that I didn't take, you know, instead of becoming a doctor, maybe one of them's taken up art or English or languages or being a chef. And, you know, there are multiple points where I've got a crossroads or multiple paths. And, you know, there are likely universes out there in which there are versions that took the other path, and for better or worse, I don't know. I don't want to think too much about the past for me anyway. I always like to have this kind of philosophy that was built into me by my dad, that everything happens for a reason. And even, you know, and it's actually, I used to think, you know, that was a bit of a, you know, rubbish philosophy when I was younger, like, oh, it can't happen for a reason. But as I've grown older, I've appreciated that. And also reading more about Stoic philosophy, that is, you know, amor fati, the love of fate, that is in line with what my dad was teaching me as well, that, you know, things happen for a reason. Even if you can't see the silver lining or the benefit of it now, at some point you will, even the bad moments. So, you know, I roll with the punches and I'm blessed for what I have right now. And yeah, there are loads of points where maybe I have regrets, but I don't hold on to regrets for too long.
So you've obviously gone into medicine, spoke a little bit about your drive, but why gut health and why specializing in colorectal surgery? Because me personally, I'm final year now, starting to think about my career path, and there's nothing less that I'd want to do than talk about shit all day, if I'm honest. Yeah. So tell me why colorectal surgery?
When I was in medical school, I was actually fascinated with the idea of becoming an orthopedic surgeon. And I think it was the bravado and the kudos associated with that type of surgery, and I thought, wow, that's a really cool type of surgery. And I did some orthopedics when I was a junior doctor, and it was a really great rotation. I didn't like the vibe, I didn't like the culture in orthopedics. Maybe that was a view in one specific hospital, and that, you know, tarnished my view of the entire specialty. Maybe, I don't know, but I've heard things similar from other colleagues who have worked in orthopedics, that kind of culture. I always feel that you are inclined to take the path of least resistance in life and the path where you are guided across. And I had some mentors when I was a F1 and F2 in general surgery who taught me, gave me the time of day, helped me with projects. And I thought, you know what, these are nice guys. And that's how I got into it. And the beauty of general surgery is that it's so diverse. You can be a general surgeon who specializes in breast, bariatric, esophagastric cancers, colorectal cancers, biliary, pancreas, a number of things, trauma, and that's actually what I want to specialize in trauma and emergency surgery rather than colorectal. And I think that is the beauty of general surgery. It's so diverse and there are so many things you can do. It's never boring. It is a lot of work and it's very busy and it's tough work. It's honest work, but yeah, I genuinely enjoy it. And I don't think I could be doing any other specialty in surgery or any other, you know, field in medicine.
That path of least resistance, you talk about that. I think a lot of medics are kind of comfortable in that zone. I don't know if you've read the book, The Big Leap by Gay Hendricks. He talks a little bit about the zone of excellence and how a lot of high achieving people are stuck in the zone of excellence because it's comfortable. But actually to break out of this zone and truly enter into full potential, your zone of genius, you have to not be comfortable. And it's interesting because that path of least resistance, it's almost ingrained in us at med school, where you finish med school, you then do your foundation post, you then follow the traditional career route, whether it is you do your core surgical training or you do the GP route. Everything is kind of set out for you. It's like a path that is set out and it's just easy just to follow along that path. But you did something different, which is obviously step outside of that path and kind of pave your own route. And you are hugely successful now. You are known as TikTok's favorite surgeon. You've accumulated, I think, across all social media platforms as of today, around 8 million followers. And that all started by you producing content online. And that is very much out of the ordinary, very much not down the path of least resistance.
Yeah, I'll just first clarify, by path of least resistance, what I meant specific to the clinical side was, you know, resistance in terms of people. I don't want to work in an environment that is against me and toxic. And I found that an orthopedic environment was toxic. And for me, that was a very resistant environment, which I didn't want to continue my training there. And I wanted to go into general surgery because people were nice. I want to work with nice people. I want to have a good job satisfaction. And that is key for me. In terms of the kind of resistance you meant and putting yourself in uncomfortable situations, I do enjoy that. You know, I do enjoy the thrill of competition, the thrill of testing myself and knowing that even if I fail, eventually I'm going to do it. And that's the mindset I like to have. And although I hate failure, I also enjoy it in a weird kind of masochistic way because I know that I'm getting closer to cracking it every single time. And for me, you know, social media started out as just an adventure. It still is an adventure to this day, but it now has forged itself into another second career for me. For me, social media started off as just a tool to educate. I've always been an educator. I've enjoyed teaching other people and offering my lessons and my knowledge. And that started in medical school when I'd finished my OSCE exams, the clinical examinations in my third year, and in my fourth year, I was mentoring people in those same examinations, the people in the year below me. And I found online, this was back in 2011, 2012, there weren't many good resources online to teach people, medical students and other healthcare professional students, these clinical skills. And I thought, hang on, there's a niche here to make educational videos for this. There were some videos out there, but they were poor quality. They were non-English. The recording was crap. And I thought, you know, that's what I can do. And a couple of other med students who were friends of mine, we banded together, scripted, produced, acted, did all this simulation stuff, put it out there. And we got a little bit of a cult following. And I just really enjoyed the producing, the scripting, the acting, being in front of the camera. And all of that continued to this day. And it's something which I didn't predict it would come to this level. Once I saw some interest in TikTok and Instagram and YouTube, I continued and I found out what worked, and that door was slightly ajar, and then I kicked it open because I knew what worked and I kept going. And you know, there's always a worry for a creator. If I call myself a creator in my second career, there's always the worry that, you know, when is the end? And I think the only person who calls time on the career or your career is yourself. You need to evolve with the times. What I do now compared to when I started in 2012 or even 2019 is vastly different. If you look at my TikTok videos or YouTube videos from 2019 and compare it to today's videos, completely different world.
And so what was the drive around specifically health content now? Because you are on a mission to disseminate accurate educational health information to the world, but whilst entertaining. So where did that mission stem from?
So I always want to be true to myself and lean on my own strengths. And, you know, I enjoy both education, and I'm a doctor with an interest in research and science and keeping up to date with things going on in the world. I'm a curious person by nature, and I love science, technology, and, you know, all of these fascinating new developments, health tech and the such. And all of my content is born out of my curiosity and my interests. I'm not claiming to be an expert in any one thing, and I'd be very wary of people calling themselves outright experts without credentials. It's just me on a journey to learn more things, exploring my curiosity, and sharing my findings with my audience. And those findings that I'm sharing are a result of dedicated research and distilling complex information that I find in scientific journals into lay speech for the average person. And I think that's what I do. You know, I'm not claiming to be a professor of cardiology speaking to you about rare pediatric congenital heart disorders. I'm teaching people about simple cardiovascular anatomy, or how to improve the health of your heart, or what can make it worse, or explaining a weird heart condition that someone might see online. I keep it very basic and entertaining and educational. And that's all it is. You know, I'm not selling anything except free knowledge.
You said that you're not selling anything. So let me ask you, has money ever been a driver for you? Because you're beginning now to build multiple streams of income, whether it is your podcast that's been backed by Sony, and you recently released your book, big congratulations, hit the Sunday Times number one bestseller, which is amazing, which I'll be leaving as a link in the description for anyone that wants to check it out. Has money ever been a motivator for you?
I think anyone who says it's not a motivator to some degree is lying, or they're already plush with money. And I think that's the taboo in the room for a lot of doctors talking about money. And I wouldn't say it's the number one motivator, but you want to be comfortable in life and you want to be rewarded for the effort you put in. I didn't continue social media to this level to be doing everything for free. And no creator is planning to do that. Every creator in the world who is on social media does it with the aim of sustaining an income, for financial freedom, for stability. And that's all these factors in there. There is no altruistic person on social media who is doing everything for absolutely free. And you don't have to be evil to do that. You can make money without taking money from audiences for dodgy products. For example, you make videos on YouTube and you can get money from ad revenue. So that's not costing the user any money up front. Same with TikTok, with Instagram, all of these things. And even brand deals, if you do a brand deal with a company, that is just like someone seeing an advert on TV. The person doesn't have to buy the product. At no point does someone's audience have to buy any product. There's no one forcing anyone to do anything unless you put your content behind a paywall to see it. And even then, if it's great content and you're providing a freemium service where you provide lots of free content and then a premium content behind a subscription like a Patreon, I think that is all fair. And people, you know, there are millions of creators who have paved that path and shown you that that's a viable option. The most successful YouTube channels have Patreon accounts with tens of thousands of followers because those audience members are invested in their creator. That, you know what, I really like this creator. They make amazing content. I'm going to pay them an extra $5 a month to see behind the scenes extra content. So is money a main motivator? No. Is it a thing that I would be interested in to continue this career so I can actually sustain it and, you know, continue to upgrade my production, hire people to help me to make it even better for the audience and the end consumer? Yeah.
The reason I asked that question is because I think when building a following, a lot of creators do struggle to successfully monetize their audience whilst maintaining their morals. Because usually monetizing an audience involves a sponsor coming to you, offering a brand deal to a creator for X amount of money. And it will be the creator and the sponsor that win, and ultimately the audience will lose. And we've seen that with like tons of crypto scams, buy this shit coin and it will pump to the moon. And then immediately when the audience buys it, it dumps. Whereas a good sponsor does, as you said, look like where everyone wins, where you're actually providing genuine value.
Yeah, I mean, for me, that's where money is not the prime motivation. For me, it's a byproduct of what I do. So for me, it's making good content so the video does well. And if the video does well, I can make some money from ad revenue. That's my model. And these big deals that come in from pseudoscientific companies and supplement companies and other dodgy scam-like things, which I can smell a mile away, is not a motivation for me. And unfortunately, I see creator after creator after creator that many people watching this podcast will recognize the names of. I won't mention that. But these people promote the same scams that I turn down. You know, the same supplement companies. You see the best creators or the creators with the highest number of followings promote the hell out of it. Why? Either they are stupid and they don't know that it's a bullshit product, or they want the money, or it's a combination of both, or it's a combination of that they know it's bullshit, but they just want to do it for that money. So, you know, it's really one of two options there. And I don't think that's an excuse. You can't use stupidity as an excuse for promoting a product, because if you don't know the science, if you don't back it up with research, you should stay away from it. So I feel quite strongly about products like this, because at the end of the day, I'm a doctor who treats patients. And if the patients are believing some nonsense that they read online that XYZ supplement can improve this, this, and this, then that's a problem for me at the end of the day, because I will be dealing with issues and I will be dealing with potentially non-compliance with patients because they're listening to rubbish online.
So this next question is a little bit clickbait, but there's a reason to why I'm asking it. So how much money do you make? And the reason I'm asking that is because I can imagine now the income generated from you practicing as a doctor is a small sliver of your overall income. And so why are you still practicing as a doctor?
So for me, I would say I'm one of the creators with this size who probably isn't monetized as much as they could be. And that is by choice. My only main monetizing routes would probably be the book deal that I signed with Penguin, money from YouTube revenue. And if I go to speaking events where I'm invited to speak for companies or big conferences or events, they'll offer a fee. And in the grand scheme of things, you know, that's not a huge monetizing thing compared to a lot of top creators who have merchandise and products and they do lots of brand deals probably on a weekly basis. I don't really. If you look through my accounts, you won't see any brand deals. I generally don't do things like that. So the reason I'm practicing is nothing to do with money. Money is one factor. Like, you know, I'm still earning my salary through being a doctor and it's a regular income, which is stable, but also because I enjoy operating and I think it gives you credibility to still be an active practicing doctor in this world, because you need to keep up to date with your knowledge, and you cannot keep up to date with knowledge if you are not at the front line, if you're not at the bleeding edge. You cannot. You can read all the bloody papers you want and read up all the research online, but you need to be seeing patients and actually in the hospital to actually be up to date with what's going on in the world.
Do you still work full time?
So this year I've gone to 80%, which means there's one day a week which is flexible for me. And in the real world, 80% for a non-medic is full-time. You know, I work 40 hours a week, which is definitely full-time for any profession in the world. But for medicine, it's less than full-time, technically, which is wild to think about.
So where does this discipline and drive come from being a full-time surgeon to then also juggling a completely whole full-time job creating content online? You have multiple different channels, a whole multiverse of Dr. Karan, like the podcast, the book as well.
I like being busy. I like doing multiple things, and I think it's a privilege to be busy. It means that people want to hear from me, people want to speak to me, people want to offer me things. I have some value to provide to people. So I think being busy is a blessing, and I would rue the day where I'm not busy and able to fill my days with things to do. And I genuinely enjoy it. And for me, I'm pretty good at compartmentalizing things, segregating things. And I think that's the surgeon in me. I'm really able to ruthlessly divide up my day into certain things. You know, I've got time to walk my dog, go to the gym, make dinner, spend time with family and friends, you know, just downtime where I'm just zoning out in front of the TV, making videos, chatting to friends, work, sleep. I'm able to just quickly prioritize. And that is something which I've worked on over time, where you have to improve your own work-life balance. And ultimately, when you get to a certain point, it becomes easier to do that. I'm not the busiest person in the world. There are people far busier than me who also are able to, you know, manage their time effectively. And the truth is, you don't need to be a productivity expert or, you know, all of this kind of bullshit to balance everything. If you want a real productivity expert, go speak to a nurse who's a mother of 3 or 4 kids, maybe who's working a full-time job doing night shifts and it's still managing, you know, a proper life. You don't need to listen to random, you know, gurus online who are, you know, claiming all these things.
I feel like you've guessed my next question, which was going to be around. So your book was, of course, released on the same day as Ali Abdul's Feel Good Productivity. And so I thought it'd be fitting to ask you a question around productivity hacks. And so what are your thoughts on productivity in general? Any hacks that you have?
Productivity, I think, is... I don't know, like, I don't think there's a real science to it. And certainly none that I've read. Any research in productivity is a lot of wishy-washy type stuff. It's not like science in the field of physiology or medicine or surgery. You know, it's a lot of wishy-washy surveys, hypotheses, psychologists looking at certain things. You know, who comes up with the productivity things? You know, who comes up with... you go into deep flow work, or I don't understand a lot of these terminologies, where they come from. It's a lot of woo science. It's woo. And what I mean by woo is that it's someone that said something, and if that person says it enough times, it becomes true. It's a frequency illusion. You know, it's kind of like these kind of the whatever rule. You know, it's like a catchy thing, like, oh, do the 10-6-5 rule. You know, that will help with whatever. You know, 10 minutes before this, do 6 things and 5 things. I do not understand productivity. All I know is that I am extremely productive without doing any of those things. And if someone wants to learn productivity, you're not going to find it in a book. You're not going to find it anywhere. You know, it is something you figure out over time. You can certainly learn things from other people, for sure. And I think, you know, there's loads of great YouTube channels, and Ali Abdul has a great YouTube channel where he covers lots of great productivity stuff. But I don't think there's any science to it. It's learning from people like him who have been productive, and you can learn things from that. And that is how you work. And I think a lot of these packages and tools and things we have, it's just a way to sell things, you know, like buy my course where I take you through productivity hacks or something like that. You know, I don't know, like this is my personal feelings. You know, people may disagree with that, but, you know, I don't think there's any hacks. And I think you need to balance productivity with resting as well. There's something called toxic productivity, where you can be too productive and focused on just the outcome without taking care of yourself.
I do agree with you. If you want to learn about productivity, go ask a nurse how they're doing those shifts. Go ask a surgeon how they are juggling their time with their family. I think that's where true productivity lies. And this next question is, I'm going to give a shout out to Vishal. He's the head of YouTube Health, and I know he'd kill me if I didn't touch on how you actually create content as a doctor. So to walk me through your process, maintaining that professional integrity, but then producing accurate, engaging content, because I know you're very data-driven as well.
Yeah, I am data-driven to some extent, in that I do like to have a look at metrics and analytics and just to see how it's all doing and just to check my general trend. But more recently, I've devolved myself from that, and I just like to make stuff which I like to do. And almost I would say there's a subconscious element where I think my years of looking at data and seeing what works and trialing and error and all that sort of thing is almost built into my content creation code. So even though I'm not so you know, looking at the granular detail of the analytics, maybe that is all now in my subconscious where I don't have to look at it, but I just know from looking at a piece of content, like, do you know what? This needs to go here and that's going to go viral. So I sort of know when I make a certain video, I know if it's going to do well based on what I say and the style. And I've become increasingly more adept at figuring out what works and what doesn't work. And for me, the style of content I do is that I'm, you know, talking about medical science and health stuff. At the end of the day, I want to provide value. I want to provide entertainment and I want to address a person's pain point, whether that's a question they might have, a common condition which many people might suffer from, or just a weird phenomenon that someone sees online and wants an explanation for. So that's what it is, and something that's relatable and shareable.
Additionally as well, so what does your process look like? Because you have tons of ideas. You're always consistently pushing out new content, new different ideas as well. So what's your brainstorming process like?
To be honest, I have more ideas than I have time to produce them. And if I did this full time, I'd be pumping out content, you know, all hours of the day. My process is that, I'll sort of narrow down like maybe a few video ideas and I'll just pick the one which I'm feeling at the moment is going to do the best. And I just do that. And I've got a log of multiple, you know, I would say hundreds of video ideas, some videos that I've saved that I might react to, video ideas that I've noted down. I've got hundreds. And, you know, this is going back to 2019. I've got stuff from 2019, which pages and pages of Word documents that I've not even scratched the surface of those ideas. And maybe I never will, but it's just my mind is always active with stuff to talk about.
Do you think it's something you just have? Like you just have this spark in you, which is like you have these ideas that are just jumping out of nowhere and you're executing them. I don't want to sound grandiose when I say this, but like, do you think it's something inherently special about you?
No, I think it's just over time I've got used to figuring out what works. I mean, I've done this for a number of years now and I've produced a lot of short videos and a lot of videos in general over the years. So whenever someone does something so frequently and for so long, they become better. They become more skilled at figuring out what works. And when I was first starting, it was more laborious. It was more of an uphill task. It was a steeper learning curve, learning how to edit, what works, how to figure things out. So nothing special about me at all, but I've made myself better by investing my time and effort into the process.
You mentioned that you have more ideas than you know what to do with. I was going to ask you, are you familiar with the Minecraft YouTuber Quibblecop?
No.
So he's basically, I didn't know if you played Minecraft, but the reason I'm asking is because he's basically cloned, using AI, he's cloned his face and his voice, and he now produces purely AI-generated content based on an AI script that reacts to real gameplay footage. So he's not actually in any of these videos.
Wow.
But and people are watching and it's doing pretty well. Obviously not as well as his real content that he used to produce, but still he has a channel with over 10 million subscribers. And so the question is, if your mission is really to disseminate accurate health information to the world, put a smile on everyone's face, and what is stopping you is your time, would you consider doing something similar that could 10x your output effectively?
I don't know, because I think I don't know how accurate AI would be in the health and medical space. I think reacting to gameplay is one level, but then providing health information is another level, because then someone would have to check the content to see if it's accurate. And that would also take time. So that, again, defeats the purpose of me outsourcing to AI, because I have to go through and check it. And if it's not accurate, I have to redo it myself. So actually it would be more stressful. The risk reward ratio in that is not worth it, because the risk is that all it takes is one slip up with AI to make something completely wrong that I've missed, and it goes out there and it's bullshit and it affects my credibility, which is priceless to me. So would I do that? No. Is that something interesting, and could AI help with other areas to help my content creation? Yeah, with the editing, with chopping up the content into small clips from longer form, maybe helping with scripting in the future as it gets better. Yeah, all of these things are potential, but animations. But would I let it take over me and clone me and provide information on my behalf in this day and age in 2023? No.
Let me challenge this. So what is valuable about you is obviously your face and the reputation you built, in the fact that your brand integrity is all around the fact that you're not going to bullshit your audience and it's always going to be true, accurate information. So what if you were to oversee this whole creative process, you hire medical content writers and you expand this kind of Dr. Karan Rajan brand and have a process similar to Mr. Beast?
Yeah, if I trusted those medical experts enough that could oversee the process and they could all verify everything the AI was saying was accurate, and the AI sounded, well, if the AI was indistinguishable from me, completely indistinguishable, like you could not tell it was AI, and you could, it was completely exactly like what I would say, which I don't think we have the technology for in this day and age right now. We do not have that technology for the average consumer. Okay, maybe somewhere in a lab, somewhere in open AI labs, they might have that. But for the average person, that is not available. So I would not do that, because I also think it's a bit of a low blow to the audience who follows you. It's a bit lazy. And I think people love the effort. People love you putting effort in. I enjoy being in front of the camera. You know, I'm not just interested in stats and output and, okay, let's put out 10 reels and 10 this and 10 that. I'm not from the Gary V school of content. You know, I'm about authenticity, my own brand, my face, doing things I enjoy is part of my purpose. You know, getting up in the morning, I'm thinking about content, what I'm going to produce. I enjoy being in front of the camera. I enjoy like talking about different things. You know, like going on people's podcasts. It's enjoyable to chat to another human being. Doing AI, what's the point? What are you going to do with all the free time you've got? Like, you're going to be monitoring the content and monitoring the stats. Like, you will then completely go behind the scenes. I think it's ridiculous.
YouTube released something a couple of weeks ago around Charlie Puth and the artist Charlie Puth is a singer. And now you can generate any type of song using Charlie Puth's voice. And you can make it something crazy about like the alphabet or, I don't know, like the COVID pandemic. Make like a funny song using his voice. And so it is interesting, because I'm thinking, why would anyone want to do that? Why would anyone want to create a Charlie Puth song that no one's actually going to properly listen to it, right? And you spoke a little bit about your roadmap there, 5-10 years. So what's on the horizon for you? You've obviously just released your book, and I'm sure that's keeping you super busy. Is it too early to start talking about book number two?
My lips are sealed.
No comment. What about the podcast?
Yeah, podcast, I'm going to pick back up in February. Had a little bit of a hiatus because focus on the book stuff and work got busy. But yeah, picking up back in, you know, next month. So I'm excited for that. And yeah, I mean, I think the year is going to be mainly about the book and growth on YouTube and making more consistent long form content, which I've struggled with purely because of time. And maybe even a book tour. That could be something in the horizon.
And as we close the podcast, so the way I got you on the podcast was, of course, I wrote you a letter, which I handed to you. And you posted on social media that letter did make a bit of an impact. And that's the reason you were coming on my podcast. And I want to quote what you said, because it really did mean a lot to me. And you said that you were mentioning that you wished that you'd have my level of persistence and drive at my age, and that you thought I'd be successful. And that meant the world to me, honestly, more than you could ever imagine. So I wanted to close the podcast by asking you something along the lines of, what would you have told yourself at the start of your 20s if you could go back? And by extension to that, what advice would you tell me?
For me, if I sort of went back and spoke to myself, I wouldn't change anything. I'll just say, you know, keep going, it gets better. That's it.
And then what about me now?
I'd say the same. Keep going. It's going to get better. You know, everything. Awesome. I mean, your best moments of your life are waiting for you to grab. You know, you're in your early 20s. You've got, you know, more than likely some incredible moments waiting for you just, you know, a few years around the corner. From now, even a few years around the corner and beyond then, it's going to be great.
Karan, this means a lot, and thank you so much for joining me on the podcast.
Thanks, man.
Thank you so much for getting to the end of the podcast. Please, please make sure you hit that subscribe button and share this episode with as many people as possible. You can watch my latest health tech video on how Elon's Neuralink brain chip is changing humanity forever here, or you can watch my other documentary on Apple's plans to dominate the healthcare industry here. Until next time, and see you soon.